Coming up on Harvest, she was abandoned as an infant, but thankfully her story didn't end there. Singer Kenzie Walker shares her incredible message of hope with us. And in Connections, discover what comes after the resurrection of Jesus in part two of Pastor Mark's series, Easter's Over, Now What? And here on Harvest, we call it the Upper Room. Pastor Charles is actually standing by in the prayer line chapel with today's prayer request, so don't go anywhere. The Harvest Show starts right now. Hello and welcome to The Harvest Show. The gang is growing. Mr. Chuck Freebie is back. And I don't know, were you out there checking out all the NCAA Final Four stuff, or you have more important things to do?
On my television, I was. I was in Pittsburgh over the weekend for some baseball, and then
Baseball,
and then it had probably been about 3 weeks since I had an actual day off, so I decided that might be nice to reunite with my family.
Reintroduce myself. Good
as
for you,
husband and father.
You remember me?
Yeah, exactly.
I keep track of him on Facebook. I mean, I find out everything that's going on in his life by just kind of reading his post and his sports commentary. I'm telling you, this man is awesome at what he does.
He is. He's a pro. Listen to this story, guys.
Okay.
Iowa churches plan to distribute thousands of Bibles to homes, or to each home, in their city. And nearly 20 churches located near Marshalltown, Iowa, are coming together with an initiative to distribute 12,000 Bibles to every home in their city. It's called Hope for You, Hope for Iowa. And those churches are going to be going door to door, helping distribute those Bibles to each home. And kind of neat initiative there. It's about an $18,000 project, they said. And something that's never been done in around that area. So the question is, how are folks going to receive that in Marshalltown?
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see. You know, this will give them an opportunity, of course, to kind of strike up a, you know, a conversation about that Bible and the gospel, but also to build relationships, because I find that people come to faith in Christ easier when they know you, you know.
Yeah.
The other question I'd have is, how many people in Marshalltown, Iowa, don't
have
a Bible.
Bible?
Because you're right in the heart of the Bible Belt right there. You're, I would wonder how many of those people don't already have one. I applaud the effort by Pastor Robinson and the rest of the churches there. On the other hand, I wonder how much research went into this, because you kind of wonder if the money might be better spent in other ways.
Yeah. Speaking of Bibles, and just coming back from Iraq there, one of the things that stood out the most to me, and I had spoken to a couple people yesterday that asked me some questions. It's called an interview. And I said, what stood out the most to you? What did you really see that you didn't expect? And one of the things was just the incredible hunger for the gospel among the Syrian refugees in Iraq. And we had handed out with our food packs illustrated story of Jesus at one of the distribution sites, and they were voluntary. They weren't in the packs. There was a gentleman there and a lady, a different volunteer, and they're handing out if you'd like one. Almost everyone took one, and the amazing thing was once they got out of that little area that we were doing the food distribution, and they'd put down their family food pack, and guys in groups of two or three would sit there, and they were reading. They weren't talking to one another. They weren't texting on their phone. You know, they weren't just like paging through it to look at the pictures. They were reading the story of Jesus, or sitting down on the curb, or a bunch of ladies against a stone wall, sitting down reading the story of Jesus. And the hunger there was absolutely amazing. The folks that were working with the Bible Society of Iraq as our ground partners, they're receiving the shipments of aid that's coming in from Feed the Hungry, also through World Compassion Terry Law Ministries. They handed out about 500 Bibles. They brought 500 Bibles to another distribution site and just had them there on a table, and again, free for the taking, and everyone was gone. Every family took one, and then they stood around or sat around for hours after the distribution was over, asking questions, asking for an explanation about what does this mean, and what was this the same Abraham that's in the Quran, and all that kind of thing. And just the incredible sincere, genuine hunger for the Word of God was amazing.
Well, Stephen, are there churches there, or is there someone there on the ground who can continue now that Feed the Hungry
yes.
is gone?
Yeah, yeah. Well, we're not gone. This is a monthly thing for Feed the Hungry.
Okay, that's right.
And we're working with local pastors and local Christian leaders there. There are no churches in Kurdistan that are out in the areas that we were at, which is close to the Iranian border, actually. Christianity is allowed. There's freedom of religion, but the government will not issue permits to build church structures. It's a very conservative area. They said, meet in your homes, all's good. So they have house churches.
Yeah.
And that's part of the thing, that's part of the reason why this is such a critical moment in time, is these food distributions, these supplies, these relief supplies are building a bridge so that these pastors and Christian leaders can visit with these people each and every week and really build that relationship for the gospel.
Now, somebody who was with you there in Iraq helping distribute those Bibles is, I don't know, I haven't been watching the show, I have to admit, the last couple of days, so I have no idea.
Where in the world?
Where in the world is Pete Sumrall, our CEO? I see the globe spinning somewhere towards the South Pacific. Where are you today, Pete?
Well, I'm here in beautiful Honolulu. Right behind me is Diamond Head. I'm on Waikiki Beach.
Oh, it's a rough life, but somebody's got to do it. When did you get there?
I got here yesterday, and this was the last stop for me on this current trip, which started in Erbil, Iraq, and then Manila, Philippines, and now Honolulu. And I'll be home by the end of the week.
Well, I know you're probably there on business, but that's not why most people go there. Talk about the tourist attraction of Honolulu there.
Well, there's a lot of visitors, as you can sometimes tell from just out here around the beach and some of the tourist areas. There's about 8 million tourists who come here every year. And so it's a very busy place, and tourism is certainly very, very important.
Well, with so many tourists there, what is the state of the economy there?
Well, actually, they have several different areas of how the economy works here. There's, of course, number one, the military, and that's a very important aspect with Pearl Harbor and Hickam Air Force Base, Schofield Barracks, Kaneohe Marine Base. It's very, very important to the state and to the economy overall, and this has been a great support place for the U.S. military throughout all of the Asia area.
Well, for our viewers who don't know, tell us a little bit about our station there, KWHE TV 14.
Well, KWHE Channel 14, we purchased it back in the middle 80s, and it's done very well. It's been a great opportunity for us to be able to reach out. We continue to work locally with a lot of different churches and groups, and it's a great thing for us to be able to do. And we really do love the local environment and love working with local people.
You mentioned tourism as a major player in the economy of Hawaii. What other sectors of industry kind of contribute to the overall economy?
That's a great question. Actually, agriculture is very important here still. Pineapples and those kind of fruits and all are very important. But really, the reality is that the majority of consumable items as well as manufactured groups goods are all imported here, whether it's come from Asia or comes from the mainland. There's a very high level of imports that have to come through here because there's little to no manufacturing whatsoever. But agriculture is still very important. A lot of pineapples are still growing here despite its being declined in a way. And sugarcane used to be a big deal and that sort of thing. But that's all kind of going away as they found that the land might be worth a little bit more in some kind of development.
Mm. Well, I would imagine the fact that everything's got to be brought in impacts the cost of living. What is the cost of living like there for the folks that just live on the island day in, day out?
Well, the cost of living is indeed very, very high, and it's something that we should be praying about and pray for the people who work and live here. It's a very expensive place to live, and consequently, a lot of times that creates a lot of issues and challenges, and so we do get a lot of calls for prayer from people who live in Hawaii. A lot of it has to do with finances as a root cause of problems, and that leads to a lot of other trouble. And so we're very glad that we can be a part of the community here in Hawaii overall, and very glad that we're able to reach out and touch people with the message of the gospel and help and believe God for miracles.
Well, Pete, thanks for joining us today. Glad you could chat in and chime in and give us some good input there.
Hey, great. Good to be with you. We'll be back again tomorrow.
All right, wonderful. Well, you know, Hawaii needs the gospel too.
Many years ago,
Dr. Sumrall knew the importance of reaching out there, and LeSEA Broadcasting touches a number of the islands, and for some time, World Harvest Radio's antenna, major big just network of antennas going to, pointing towards Asia. That's now moved to Palau. But the philosophy and the ministry model's the same there at KWHE in Honolulu. Local ministries on the air, so pastors have a platform to share the gospel and to kind of present what their churches are offering across the airwaves. National ministries bringing the gospel into the state of Hawaii, and then a lot of good family entertainment, family-friendly entertainment as well, and it's touching lives.
So they've traded sugar cane for solar cane.
So, okay. All right. On that note, we will invite you to join the conversation. You can friend us, you can follow us, you can send your emails directly to the set of Harvest by going to live@lesea.com. The international news is next.
Now, on this Wednesday, April 8th, 2015, here's what's happening in your world. A white South Carolina police officer has been charged with murder hours after law enforcement officials viewed a dramatic video that appears to show him shooting a fleeing black man several times in the back. We do warn you, this may be difficult for some to watch. The video of Saturday's shooting, which began as a traffic stop over a faulty brake light, has now been released to news media outlets that shows City Patrolman Michael Thomas Slager firing 8 shots at 50-year-old Walter Lammer Scott's back as Scott is running away. Scott falls on the 8th shot, fired after a brief pause. Authorities said Scott was shot after the officer had already hit him with a stun gun. The video then shows the officer slowly walking toward him, ordering him to put his hands behind his back. This story surfaces as Americans grapple with issues of trust between law enforcement and minority communities after a series of deaths of unarmed black men at the hands of police. Scott's family welcomes the murder charges against the policeman. The family and their lawyer held a news conference in Charleston shortly after Mayor Keith Summey announced the charges.
We can't get my brother back. And my family is in deep mourning for that. But through the process of justice has been served. And I don't think that all police officers are bad cops, but there are some bad ones out there. And I don't want to see anyone get shot down the way that my brother got shot down.
The family's attorney, Chris Stewart, praised the hero who filmed the video for having the courage to put it forward, arguing initial reports stated something totally different. Stewart said the family does plan to sue the police department. Defense Secretary Ash Carter says the first revision of U.S.-Japan defense guidelines in 17 years will rebalance that bilateral alliance. Carter says the guidelines, expected to be formally approved in about 3 weeks, will help the U.S. and Japan to respond flexibly to challenges in the Asia-Pacific region. Carter, who travels to South Korea later this week, is on his first trip to Asia since becoming defense secretary in February. Asked about the Middle East, Carter said the chaos in Yemen is making it harder to conduct counterterrorism operations there. A tunnel being constructed with the alleged aim of smuggling drugs into the United States was found in the border city of Tijuana Tuesday. The tunnel, which extended about 500 feet from its point of entry, was equipped with electricity and ventilation systems. It was found below a house under construction located near the city's airport and 2 blocks away from the federal police offices in Tijuana. The passage was unfinished. It was not believed to have reached U.S. soil. The Baja California state attorney said 9 people were arrested in the house where 20 kilos of marijuana were found. And French air traffic controllers are on strike today, prompting the cancellation of 40% of the flights across France. Travelers have to wait for long hours for another flight or make stopovers in other locations to continue their journeys. The powerful National Union of Air Traffic Controllers called the two-day strike over a quarrel regarding working and retirement conditions. France's Civil Aviation Agency says part of the dispute involves conditions for raising the retirement age for controllers from 67 to 69 years. Further strikes are planned later this month to coincide with spring school holidays in France. Still to come, discover what comes after the resurrection of Jesus in part two of Easter is Over, Now What? But up next, abandoned as an infant, her story does not end there. Singer Kenzie Walker shares her incredible message of hope. We're right back with more Harvest after this.
Dr. Lester Sumrall said that faith comes not by prayer, but by continually feeding on God's Word. Paul the Apostle wrote that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. LeSEA Broadcasting's Partner in Faith make it possible for millions to hear the Word of God in over 190 countries, whether by television, shortwave radio, free Bible distribution, a 24-hour daily prayer line. Souls hear the gospel. Will you join our fellowship of partners in faith? With every soul you reach for Jesus Christ, you're laying up treasure in heaven. We need your help to reach the lost for Jesus Christ. You can be a partner in faith for as little as a monthly gift of $25. Call 1-800-365-3732 and tell the prayer operator you want to be a partner in faith. Call today, 1-800-365-3732.
Come down.
Imagine if you had one day left to live and you'd want a Bible open at your side. Today, in countries where Christians know they could die tomorrow, LeSEA's broadcasts are often the only source of comfort from God's Word. They can change the heart of even a hardened terrorist. As thanks for your gift to support these vital broadcasts, we'd love to send you a copy of Lester Sumrall's timeless book, Jerusalem, Where Empires Die. Call LeSEA Broadcasting at 1-800-365-3732.
Are you tired yet have trouble sleeping? Wired yet can't focus? Let's face it, you only get one life. It's time to start living. It's time for a new you. Introducing the new you pack from Making Healthy Choices. This incredible package includes vitamin B12 with folic acid to promote focus and support cardiovascular health, vitamin D3 to build strong bones and muscles, vitamin E400, an all-natural antioxidant, and mineral concentrate, a fulvic acid trace mineral product essential for maximum cell function and performance. This exclusive offer is yours for the low price of $49.95, and shipping is free. You won't find these products in stores only by calling 1-800-965-2345 or by logging on to mhclife.com. It's time for a new you. It's time for life.
ISIS terrorists have slaughtered thousands of Christians and moderate Muslims across the Middle East. Over a million people have fled their homes. Many, after being given the ultimatum, convert to Islam or die. They've lost everything because they refused to renounce Christ. With every hour that passes, the situation grows worse for tens of thousands of people who were driven from their homes by ISIS. Feed the Hungry has committed to support these refugees by providing a box of food that would last an entire month. Today, with your gift of $70, you can help five families know that they are not forgotten. We need you to act now. Please call 1-877-769-9268 or visit feedthehungry.org.
Kenzie Walker has an incredible story of survival, though she was just an infant when she was left in a box at a train station. Mm. She spent her first year of life in an orphanage in China. Kenzie may only be 11 years old, but I tell you, she has a voice in her body that's amazing, as you just heard, and she's sharing a message of hope and joy. Welcome to the Harvest Show, Kenzie.
Well, thank you.
Okay, so you do have this booming personality, because I met you in the green room, and I want you to know, no, you cannot have my job. I'm going to keep my job. And you have an amazing voice.
Thank you.
But where does all of this come from? Kind of tell us your backstory. I'm sure your parents had to tell it to you, but you were left at a train station in a box.
I was. I was only 1 month old. Well, I was born in the Hunan province of China. Mm-hmm. And I was only 1 month old when I was left by a train station in a paper box. And someone found me and took me to an orphanage. And I spent the first year of my life there, and then my parents from Lubbock, Texas adopted me.
Wow. And you said that you actually moved to the States. They brought you back home pretty quick, which sometimes it takes quite a while. But, you know, there you were.
Here I was.
Yeah. Tell us a little bit about, and I've never quite asked an 11-year-old this, but your journey to faith. How did you come to, you know, a faith in Jesus Christ and knowing that heaven's a real place and Jesus is a real person?
I think I was 6 years old, and I was riding in the car with my mom. And I kept on asking her, like, questions about how do you get in heaven and who's Jesus and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And she actually had her phone with her, and so she looked up verses to help answer the questions.
In the car?
In the car, and we were actually at a gas station.
Oh, okay.
So it was a funny place.
Yeah.
But right then, when I figured out all this information, I thought, I want to be a Christian.
Huh.
So right then, I asked Jesus into my heart.
Wow.
Do you have any other siblings?
I have a brother, mm-hmm. and I have a sister who's disabled.
So tell us about your music, because, I mean, coming from an orphanage, are you, like, you don't seem like you're upset or anything like that, like life has been so mean to you?
I really don't remember what it was like there.
Mm-hmm.
I just can't think of anything, but I've seen some pictures, I'm like, oh, I think I kind of vaguely remember. Yeah.
But you're using, now you want to build an orphanage.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Well, I work with a business called ICM, International Cooperating Ministries, and they build churches around the world. And I get to actually build some orphanages connected to those churches.
Hmm. Mm-hmm. Any particular countries?
Close to the Philippines.
Okay.
In the Philippines.
In the Philippines, uh-huh.
That's the one I know so far, but yeah. I think I'm going to be making some
now,
more.
When did you discover this not just ability to sing, but it seems like you have a real passion, you have joy to sing. So how did that happen?
I actually don't remember a time I didn't sing, and uh-huh. I don't remember. I've heard some stories that I was, before my parents took me home, we went to a restaurant, and they said I got really bored, so I grabbed some chopsticks and I started playing around, like on chairs,
like
on
a
tables.
Beat.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. So it was kind of just going around the room.
Like you seem very normal, but you just have this amazing life. It seems like, you know, you're just on the go. You have this new CD out. You're building an orphanage. Tell us about your music and what you're singing about.
My CD is distributed by Sunny Red, mm-hmm. and I'm singing about the Lord mm-hmm. because I love Him and I want to praise Him
mm-hmm.
through my songs.
Are the songs, did you help write the song?
Actually, I didn't. Mm-hmm. I actually have a songwriter. Mm-hmm. Her name is Kenna West.
Mm-hmm. But the songs have to mean, the words have to mean something to you for you guys to agree on that.
Sure.
So when I think of an 11-year-old, almost a teenager, like, are you doing other things? To kind of share the gospel with your friends, and how do they respond to it?
Well, when I tell them that I'm actually like singing, I'm recording an album just to praise God, sometimes it's unbelievable. Sometimes mm-hmm. just because I'm thinking, oh, I'm recording an album mm-hmm. and I'm doing it for the Lord, and I feel really, really grateful that He's using music through me to help other people know God and get to praise Him also.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but a lot of 11 and 12-year-olds, they're thinking about boys. They're kind of boy crazy or girl crazy, and you're singing about the Lord. So how do your friends respond to you?
I think they kind of, I don't know, but I think they kind of just like, I think whenever they're just with me, we always kind of talk about the Lord. And so, mm-hmm. and I tell them that because they have some dreams too, everyone. And so I'm like, maybe you can, like, some of my friends like to be writers. I'm like, you could probably write a book about God, like maybe how you became interested in God. And some like to draw and.
So and use their whatever, use their talents, whatever it is.
Yeah, use it for God.
For the Lord. Now, you're in Lubbock, Texas. Do you, you have, go to school or you homeschooled?
I actually go to a school called KPA, Kingdom Prep Victoria Academy, mm-hmm. and on Mondays and Wednesdays we go to school, and then Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays we do homeschool.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other interests, like I don't know, sports or arts?
I'm not really a sport kind of girl, but mm-hmm. I do like to do. Well, I think maybe gymnastics is a little bit
okay.
of sporty.
Yeah.
And I like to do Legos for girls. So.
Uh huh. Well, that's pretty cool.
I'm kind of curious, Kenzie. Have you ever been bullied?
Bullied. I think I probably have.
Okay.
But
how do you respond to that kind of thing? Because, you know, kids who are watching or their parents are going to tell them about you and go online, and, you know, they are probably going through hardships. You know, what would you say to them?
I think I would, maybe because I've heard some stories, or maybe even stories in the Bible.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That they just have to stand up for their beliefs about mm-hmm. whatever the situation is. You have to stand up for what you think is right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And you just have to be strong about that, just to rely on God, mm-hmm. God, so that He will be with you mm-hmm. and you will fight for the right thing.
Man, that's a good answer.
I know, right?
We got just a second left, Kenzie. KenzieWorld.com is your website that mm-hmm. folks can go to. And learn a little bit more about you there. Is there any music there for them to listen to as well? A little teaser of music, maybe?
Yes, there. It's not the mastered, but on May 16th, it will be in on iTunes. It'll be in the stores.
Awesome.
So that's really the master part. But on Kenzie World, yeah, there will be some samples. So.
Well, Kenzie, I want you to know you're in one of my top interviews. I really enjoy talking to
you. And she spoke to Mrs. Hillary Clinton.
Too. Yeah, I've interviewed some actresses and actors, but I want you to know you're definitely in the top three for sure.
Thank you.
To connect with Kenzie, go to kenzieworld.com or go to harvest-tv.com. And coming up later, Pastor Mark Lantz continues with part two of Easter is Over, Now What? But up next, Kenzie performs another song from her new CD, My Soul. We'll be right back.
Awesome.
May I shake your hand, Kenzie? I wish I could get a selfie with you.
Jesus said, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Do you have some treasures like silver and gold coins or little jewelry that you don't wear anymore? Why not invest them into changing lives for Jesus? Ask yourself if these treasures are really worth keeping. Or should you invest them into making an eternal difference in someone's life? Call 1-800-365-3732 for a prepaid insured shipping envelope. Lay up your treasure in heaven. It'll be waiting for you when you get there.
Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. Again, I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything you ask for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Here at Prayer Line, we devote ourselves to prayer. 24 hours a day, we are on watch and thankful for every call that we receive. We see each caller not only as a prayer partner, but another opportunity to see God move and lives changed. If you have a need, please call us at 1-800-365-3732.
You know, it occurs to me that biblical words like vows and commitments and pledges have somehow lost their meaning in today's culture. But we expect God to keep His promises to us, so why shouldn't He expect us to keep ours? Keeping a promise isn't always easy. Sometimes it requires us to take bold steps of faith. Dr. Lester Sumrall said, when you walk in the faith realm, you must accept the Word of God or you won't make it. For example, God said, if you make a vow to the Lord your God, you shall not delay fulfilling it. For the Lord your God will surely require it of you, and you will be guilty of sin. And again he said, when you vow a vow to God, do not delay paying it. It is better you should not vow than that you should vow and not pay. God will always honor his promises to you. Remember to always honor your promises to him.
is calm after the tempest. He is springtime after the snow. He's the answer to every why. The promised presence while I cry. My soul
Many Christian ministries have desired to bring the gospel of Jesus to Israel, to proclaim his message of God's love to the villages and streets he walked while on this earth. Yet only one Christian network has been broadcasting the message of God's love to Israel for more than 10 years. By God's grace, LeSEA Broadcasting has been bringing the gospel of Jesus Christ and the voices of many American ministries to every home in Israel via Middle East television. You can help this great work by becoming a partner in faith for as little as $25 a month. Call today.
Well, this week we're discussing a subject that I've entitled, Easter is over, now what? And the point we're making is that the power of the resurrection that we experienced and celebrated last weekend really is only a prelude to what is leading you into the most powerful season of your life. You see, friend, you and I can't stay the same way that we were before Easter. There's got to be a change. And the reason is because God is about to transfer the power and the authority of the resurrection on you so that you can walk into a season of life and a season of ministry that you've never experienced before. But the only way for that to happen is for there to be an impartation, a transfer of that same power and that same authority through the Holy Spirit. In fact, one of the post-resurrection appearances that Jesus made to the disciples, he appeared in one of the rooms in which they were meeting in John 20 and verse 22. And the Bible said that he said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive ye the Holy Ghost. Now, what God is saying is that you really don't have time to rest in the laurels of a successful resurrection weekend celebration. We don't have time to sit back and talk about our success or about our victories because there's something greater that Jesus is calling us to be. Now, what's going to get us into that season? Well, let's go back to John 21 because this really is the topic of our conversation with the disciples, what they did after the resurrection. And in verse 3 of that chapter, the Bible says, Simon Peter said to them, the rest of the disciples, he said, I'm going fishing. And they said to him, well, we're going to go with you also. And they went out immediately, got into the boat, and that night they caught nothing. So here's the first post-resurrection principle that I want you to understand. What worked in your past is not going to work in your future. Peter went back to doing what he did prior to the resurrection. He cast the net just like he always did. He used the same bait that he'd always used. He probably followed the same methodology that he'd always followed in fishing. In fact, it probably felt good for him to get back in the boat, get out on the water again. Enough of this roller coaster ride of ministry and emotions. I just don't need it anymore. But it didn't take him long to find out that what worked before was not going to work this time. Because what works in one season of life will not work in another season of life. I want you to think about that, because we're post-resurrection. This is a new season for you. With Peter now, there's nothing wrong with fishing. In fact, I would say that he probably wanted to get back into the groove of being a fisherman again. I'm ready to get back to what I do best. But you see, Jesus had other plans for him. Jesus came up to the disciples after they had come to shore in verse 5, and he said this. He said, Jesus said, "Children, have ye any meat?" And they had to answer him, "No." In other words, Jesus is saying, how is what you're doing working for you? Jesus is teaching them a deeper question. He wasn't just hungry. He was teaching them that you can't go back and expect what you did prior to the resurrection to work again after the resurrection. Because Peter was going back and doing the things he did before all of this happened. But the only thing that Jesus is concerned about is what you are producing. Fruitfulness is the only criteria by which success in life and ministry can be judged. Doesn't matter how beautiful our Easter celebration was, if we're not producing the spiritual fruit of anointing and power that God wants us to produce, none of that matters. In fact, I feel like the Lord has put this upon my heart, because you are entering into this new season of life, and God wants to bring greater fruitfulness out of you than at any other time in your life. And there are some of you watching who the Lord has sent me to tell you, you are entering into this season where God is going to bring people to you who are hungry. And you can't go back to your old pattern, your old way of thinking before you experience the power of Easter. It's time now to be fruitful. Listen to the words of our Savior. Do you have any meat? What have you got to give? Let's get ready, because people need the fruit of our lives like they have never had it before. Easter is over. Now what? It's time to produce something, because the world is hungry. Let's take the blessing of Easter. Let it produce something in our lives like never before. Let's produce the fruit God wants us to produce and walk into this brand new season of life after Easter is over.
Pastor Mark will continue his series tomorrow as we take a look at part 3 of Easter is Over, Now What? But if there's something on your heart right now that you need help praying about, we encourage you to give us a call, 1-800-365-3732. If you're outside the U.S., put in your international code and dial 574-291-1010. You can also email at prayer@lesea.com. Check out the website, worldharvest.com. Or send it the old-fashioned way at 61300 Ironwood Road, South Bend, Indiana, 46614. Normally, I'd say standing by to take your call, but he's not down there by the phones today. He's up here in what we call the upper room, the chapel
upper room,
here.
That's right.
LeSEA Broadcasting. Pastor Charles joins me now. And Pastor, what has been on your heart since Easter has ended?
Well, you know, Chuck, I'm still thinking about this room. You know, we're trying to get those ones who are out there who want us to be praying in a continual way for their loved ones, for their friends, for their family, and to send us in a picture, a copy of a picture. They can email it to us. We'll take it from email, and we're going to put it on this wall. So whenever we come up here to pray, we'll be praying for those ones as well.
So if you've got your cell phone pictures, just email one of those cell phone pictures to prayer@lesea.com.
That's right. That's right.
They'll put it on the wall behind us. As you can see, there's a lot of space on the wall behind us now that they've resurface this room, and we want to fill that space with the people who are watching and need prayer. There you see some of the old pictures that were up here on the wall. We want a whole brand new batch of pictures because, well, quite frankly, we've prayed for those people for a long, long time, and
That's
now
right.
we want to be able to pray for you and your loved ones as well. And as we pray for people, prayer requests come in, and what kind of prayer requests do you have today?
Well, I have some here. Dan in Indiana. Dan says, I have seen those in bondage to homosexuality set free by God. He says, it had to be him because all of those who tried to escape its hold have failed. Please pray with me that I be added to the success list.
Okay.
All right. And then we have Laura in Michigan. Laura says, please be in agreement with me that I get deliverance from the Lord. I want the root of this anger in me taken out.
Wow.
Yeah, yeah. And then Jack in Florida says, I can't go on this way with my life. I need to be delivered from these habits. I am constant user of drugs, alcohol, and smoking. Please agree with me that the Lord sends his grace my way.
Well, the first step that all these people have taken is the right step.
Right.
And that is turning to God. Because
that's right.
No matter what the problem is, God is bigger than that problem, and
He's
he can overcome it.
That's right.
You're absolutely right. He mm-hmm. is the answer to mm-hmm. the problem. You know, in trying to solve things ourselves, rarely works is what I have found.
No, that's a failure list, Chuck. That's a failure. We always fail whenever we try to do it ourselves. God makes His presence known, and His presence is always victory.
Well, and that's why we turn to God right now in prayer. Won't you pray for the people?
Sure. Father in heaven, I thank you today for those ones who are calling in, emailing us, texting us if they can get it through, Lord God. We're just asking you, Lord, to touch them in a special way. Minister to their hearts. Bring deliverance to these lives, Lord, because we know you're the only one who can, and so do they. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen. 1-800-365-3732 is the number. Four ways to contact us. We're back with more Harvest after this.
If you are among the thousands who love the teaching of Lester Sumrall, then you should have the two-volume set of The Treasury of Lester Sumrall. Written in Dr. Sumrall's easy-to-understand style, you'll feel like you are getting a Bible school education. There are 732 individual readings, one for each day for two whole years. These beautiful devotionals will also make a wonderful gift for your friends, family, or even your pastor. Order yours today.
Today is your day. This is your moment. Life is calling. It's time to express the vitality and wellness that you've always dreamed of. And it's simple. With the exclusive new You Pack from Making Healthy Choices. Loaded with key vitamins and minerals, this all-natural supplement pack promotes the health solutions you need. So call 1-800-965-2345 or log on to mhclife.com. Act now and shipping is free. It's time for life.
Imagine if you had one day left to live, you'd want a Bible open at your side. Today, in countries where Christians know they could die tomorrow, LeSEA's broadcasts are often the only source of comfort from God's Word. They can even change the heart of a hardened terrorist. As thanks for your gift to support these vital broadcasts, we'd love to send you a copy of Lester Sumrall's book, Jerusalem, Where Empires Die. Visit LeSEA Broadcasting online today at lesea.com.
LeSEA Tours comes to Israel three times a year, February, June, and November. And we want you to join us as we experience the land of the Bible and walk through the Bible, where the Bible literally does come to life. We want to share with you more information at LeSEATours.com about how you can come to the land of the Bible and experience the Bible for yourself. For a free November tour brochure, call 1-800-685-3732 or visit LeSEATours.com.
In this special series of talks, we will be discussing with you at Jerusalem, the mystic city. We'll also be talking to you about empires die at Jerusalem. This is almost unique, and there is no other part of the world where you can say that the various empires, Asian empires, Greek empires, empires that had to do with Europe, actually began their death in a certain city. It's a tremendous study, and I know that you will certainly enjoy it. We will also be talking about the genesis of Jerusalem, the beginnings of one of the most remarkable cities that man has ever had any knowledge of. We will be speaking about how Abraham inherited the city of Jerusalem, how God gave it to him and his seed after him. Then we will study Jerusalem by time periods so that you'll be able to see how it has developed. In this very ancient area in which we're standing at the present time, it takes you so far back into history until you begin to feel how ancient this area really is. And it has a voice, a living voice, that wishes to talk to the people of our times. And that's the purpose of these special talks. In Psalm 132, verses 13 and 14, it says, Jehovah hath chosen Zion. That's a remarkable statement. He has desired it for his habitation. That's a more remarkable statement. This is my rest forever, if you can imagine it. Here will I dwell, for I have desired it. Those words happen to be in your Bible too. It'd be interesting for you to survey them and to get the feeling of actually what they mean. Our world in which we live today, from the beginning of empires, has refused to recognize Jerusalem as a capital city. I want you to accept that and to think of it very strongly. Jerusalem has never been a capital city, excepting for the nation of Israel. No one, no nation, no people have ever elevated Jerusalem as being a valuable city, a capital city, excepting the nation of Israel. Jerusalem as a city could truthfully be called the world's greatest orphan. It has been passed on from empire to empire, from nation to nation, who have pranced through this city thinking that they own it, when God himself had already designed who should own it, and man's equivocations absolutely meaningless and amounts to nothing. Our generation must know that from all history, the Jews have never left Jerusalem voluntarily. Now that you must know. They have always been forced out, or chased out, or hounded out, or shut out, but they have never walked out on their capital city. Please remember that and let it, you know, become very deeply embedded in your spirit.
God's plan for the Middle East is unfolding day by day. Now more than ever, it's clear that the Middle East is the cauldron of the end times. Take a look at what's happening there across the region, whether it's Yemen, whether it's the Spring Arab Spring states, whether it's what's going on in Syria right now, in Israel itself. We need to know how these events apply to the age in which we live. The City of Peace has a bloody history, but a future glory. And in Jerusalem, where empires die, fantastic, fantastic study by Dr. Lester Sumrall, the founder of LeSEA Broadcasting. He asked the question, will America die at Jerusalem? And it's the very last chapter of the book, very prophetic in its scope. And we want to send it to you as our partners this month. With any gift that you send in to help us continue to bring the gospel to the Middle East through Middle East Television, through World Harvest Radio, through the worldwide outreaches of LeSEA Broadcasting, with any gift this month, we want to send this to you, but you need to request it. So when you call 1-800-365-3732, make that donation, sow that seed this month, and say, yes, please send me a copy of Dr. Sumrall's book, Jerusalem, Where Empires Die. You can also go to LeSEA.com. And if I could, I don't want to let the cat out of the bag too far, but Dr. Sumrall makes this statement here. He said, "The conclusion we must draw is very sad and sobering, and it should serve as a loud warning to our beloved United States. Simply put, the United States will no longer be a world power in the end times. It will not be a significant enough nation to play a major role in the events of those days. That is a most obvious answer. What led to the waning of our power?" Well, you can continue reading in this last chapter of the book, but to say that in 1984, when American power was demonstrated in full force, after the Iron Curtain came down, after the winning of the Cold War, to make that kind of a statement would draw a lot of criticism from the church and from our nation at large.
You know, Stephen, we often say that Pastor Sumrall, Dr. Sumrall, was a man, a pastor before his time. I mean, it's interesting. I've been doing the study of Revelation, the book of Revelation, and you can take this book and put it right next to the book of Revelation, which was written more than 2,000 years ago, and this book was written in the mid-80s. But to see the truth come to light today, to see it unfold, is amazing. That's why we're saying, for a gift of any amount, we'll send you this for the support of LeSEA Broadcasting. And when we say support of LeSEA Broadcasting, you know, we're talking about Spread the Word and the Harvest Show, which reminds me, we will see you tomorrow again. We look forward to it. Bye-bye.
Paul the Apostle wrote to his beloved Philippian friends, "I thank my God upon every remembrance of you." Well, that's exactly how we feel about you, our partners in faith. We thank God every day for you, for your prayers, and for your faithful month-by-month financial support. Dr. Lester Sumrall founded LeSEA Broadcasting because God gave him a vision to win 1 million souls for Jesus. He knew he would need a faith that moves mountains. But more than that, he knew he would need thousands of committed partners who stood with him to support this huge missionary effort. Every day, LeSEA Broadcasting is reaching millions of lost men, women, and children who are seeking hope. Your loyal monthly partner in faith commitment makes it all possible. Please don't grow weary in well-doing. You are bringing hope where there is no hope. Thank you, and God bless you.
If you love God, but your faith needs refueling, be refreshed with The Harvest Show. Harvest is real and relevant with God-loving people ready to help reignite your faith with prayer, inspiring guest interviews, and great conversation about the goodness of God. Build up your spirit and your mind with international news from a Christian perspective and live reports from Israel. The Harvest Show is hosted by a team of Christians who love God and work hard to extend His love to you. When your faith needs to be renewed, watch The Harvest Show live Monday through Friday on the LeSEA Broadcasting Network. The Harvest Show is produced by LeSEA Broadcasting and is viewer supported by people just like you. Thank you for inviting us into your home today.